Cambodia is a young country recovering from a vicious recent history. While it's been inhabited since the 6th millennium BC, colonization throughout the 19th and 20th century, as well as the brutal Khmer Rouge regime in the 1970s, killed millions of Cambodians and had a devastating impact on its cultural and historical spaces. My journey begins in the capital city of Phnom Penh, a place embracing its historic glory while moving towards a bright new future. As editor-in-chief of Metro Society, I get to wear many hats when creating the best stories for our readers. I produce, I write, I strategize, and I attend events. But the best part of my job is I get to travel. From Palawan, Cebu, Bali, Hong Kong, New Zealand, and to the rest of the world. We make this show so we can take you along on my journeys to see for yourselves what it is like to be in my shoes. I am Raul Manzano of Metro Society, and this is EIC On The Move. It's my first time in Phnom Penh, Cambodia's capital. Thanks to the city's dual history, it shares breathtaking architecture from both cultures. I begin by learning more about the rich history and opulent design of the Raffles Hotel Le Royal. The hotel is a storied space, having opened 90 years ago when I came to visit. Le Royal was host to everyone from W. Somerset Maugham to Charlie Chaplin. During the war, it was home to many foreign journalists. General manager of Le Royal shares more of the hotel's incredible history with me.
When you look through the times and how Raffles as a company and our hotels evolved, what happened is in 1991, the Paris Peace Agreement was signed. King Sihanouk returned from exile shortly after that. He experienced the Raffles Hotel in Singapore, which was just newly restored back in the early 90s. And he was so impressed with Raffles did. He invited Raffles to come here. So Raffles took over these two properties in the mid-90s and opened them in 1997. So what Raffles did, and what we're still doing now, is we are very conscious about the obviously historic value of the properties, about the colonial aspects. What we're doing is we are restoring, we're not renovating.
Despite the recent updates that include USB ports and spotlighting, the hotel retains its old-fashioned wooden fans, rotary dial phones, and light switches. Hotel manager Dennis De Groot gives me a rundown of the renovations the hotel has undergone and what they can expect from the brand new Raffles.
Now, as we're moving into the new millennium, if you want to call it that, and the restoration you see around us, is where we have to now do the tweak on the guest room amenities and the soft touches. It's making it local, focusing on the Khmer amenities, and you see that in the room when you checked in yesterday, you had the Khmer suites. Yeah. And I think it's telling a story, and that's what makes our hotel so iconic, is being able to tell that story. When you go to our sister property or brother property in the Raffles and Siem Reap, and you see a lot of artwork that's focused around the temples. Now the Raffles here, we're not going to follow the temple feel, we're going to follow, of course, Phnom Penh as itself. It's got a lot of history with the Royal Palace, so yes, definitely intertwining and instilling that soft finishes, fabrics, feels into the rooms itself. Lighting is a big focus. The rooms were quite dark, and then you see that with the heavy wooden staircases and paneling. I think the rooms you're staying in now is our landmark heritage rooms.
The hotel calls itself an oasis for the well-traveled, known for its luxurious rooms and spas that offer a haven for guests in the midst of busy Phnom Penh.
And one of our personality suites, but we've recently completed one of our wings and got back a good number of rooms and very positive comments.
Every nook and cranny of a place like the Raffles has a story. As editor-in-chief of Metro Society, I'm always trying to make sense of the stories behind the places I visit. I investigate further by setting up a tour with head concierge Sam Nheanika Pann, who's got the story behind every fixture in the hotel.
As you have been at Raffles Singapore.
Yes, I was there. Yeah.
You will see the same gravel.
Gravel, okay.
It makes a sound, you know, to remember when.
So that the gravel was imported from Singapore to make the same sound,
yes,
as the gravel of Raffles Singapore.
Yes,
yes.
Yep.
Wow.
Proposed my friend architect,
uh-huh,
in late 1923,
okay,
and early 1924.
Okay.
And my friend architect, Mr. Ernest Herbab, who is friend architect who want to create Phnom Penh tallest building in city.
Sam shows me the exact marker where King Sisowat Monivong inaugurated the hotel when it opened in 1929. Sam leads me to the staircase, which has remained unchanged since the hotel opened 90 years ago.
Let me introduce the hall. On that time, we don't have a telephone.
Okay.
So if guests want to order meal, yes, shouting.
Yeah, they, yeah, shout from up there.
Yes, yes.
They say, I want breakfast.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, because before, no telephone.
Yeah.
So they will shout from up there, bring me breakfast.
Yes.
Scrambled eggs and fried eggs.
We drop the note.
They drop the note.
Yes.
Sam leads me to the staircase, which has remained unchanged since the hotel opened 90 years ago.
Let me introduce this stair.
Yeah.
It built in hotel opening.
So this is 90 years old also.
Yes. Yeah.
Same, no renovation. Same.
No renovation.
Yes.
Polish made tonight.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Just polish it, right?
Yep. So it make you, when you walk, it sound.
It's, yeah, yep, it's like creaking. Yes, right. Creaking.
So if you would like to try.
Okay. What does the creaking do? It tells the people downstairs that.
It tells the people when go up and go down.
Ah, okay. So they know when the guest is moving.
Yes.
So I'm,
yes,
going to try it now, okay?
Please.
I can hear the wood creaking. So I said, I'm awake. Get me food.
So much has passed through these halls, from Hollywood celebrities to war refugees, when the Red Cross designated the hotel as a neutral zone during the war. Today, even the original black and white tiles have been lovingly replicated so guests can feel exactly like those old Hollywood stars visiting Phnom Penh for the first time.
So Raul, welcome to your suite.
Wow.
It's André Malraux.
André Malraux suite, yeah.
The reason we put this for the history, because he's also the part of Ministry of Art and Culture of,
yes,
France.
And he visited Cambodia.
Yes.
Yes.
He loved to visit Cambodia with his wife.
This is a beautiful room.
Thank you.
You have a beautiful view of the park.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a nice terrace outside.
Yes.
Right? Yeah.
We have a little bit balcony.
I'm staying in one of the personality suites, each designed after a famous person who stayed at the hotel. U.S. First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis, French President Charles de Gaulle, English writer W. Somerset Maugham, and American actress Marilyn Monroe. The hotel has also played host to a number of foreign officials, from British royalty to American presidents and Japanese prime ministers, all enjoying a luxurious stay in the presidential suite.
Sam, thank you so much for taking me on a historical tour of the hotel. And what a great way to end the tour, in this beautiful room, which I'm going to stay in, with a beautiful balcony overlooking the wonderful green park just across the hotel. Thank you again.
Huh? My pleasure.
I've got a long itinerary ahead, but first, time to settle into my suite. Imagine if your heirloom pieces become fine dining. The Raffles Hotel Le Royal makes use of the recipes handed down within the royal family for centuries and offers these courtly dishes to its guests. Chef Joel Wilkinson tells me more about how the restaurant brings classic Khmer food to the present day. Why did they decide to turn over some of the recipes to the hotel or to the restaurant?
I think because, well, firstly, this is one of the first sort of establishments in Cambodia.
Yeah.
I mean, the original facade of the building is 1927. That in itself is a music school. So I think that was the first real established hotel. Yeah. Probably.
Yeah. And I guess the royal family wanted a dining room that would serve their kind of food.
Right. Yeah. And then of course it's called Le Royal.
Yes.
Le
yes,
Royal.
Of course, yeah.
Raffles Le Royal. Yeah. So there's a strong bond in the
yes,
terms
yeah.
of the naming
yes.
of the property. And then when rebranding, yeah. sort of 17, 18 years ago, yeah. Raffles took over,
yeah.
that it remained the
yeah,
property
yeah, yeah.
because of the recipes, yeah. because of the connections yeah. that they had already.
The royal family turned over a select number of recipes to the restaurant to keep these traditions alive.
Don't tweak the recipes. We have a bit of fun in terms of presenting. You would have noticed that some of the green plates you
yes,
rate off,
right.
I mean, they're,
yeah.
they're sort of the traditional.
Yes, uh-huh.
But we came in with a few modern plates,
yes.
a little bit of modern twist, which
yes.
is the desserts, for example.
Yes,
it's
right.
quite modern.
Yes.
But no, we follow the recipes
yeah.
Because we have other Khmer cuisine
yes.
that we can be a little bit more flexible with.
Yeah.
So the royal Khmer cuisine, is we keep that. So Chef Dareth,
yeah.
it's quite a history, was the chef in charge of this restaurant.
Of his mother?
Yeah, who had been here for 20 years,
okay.
actually, a very long time.
Yeah.
And then she retired,
yes.
which you don't get to work for too many people that actually retire.
Yes.
We felt then we gave the opportunity
yeah.
to Dareth
yeah.
go into that position, because
yeah.
we thought it was a unique experience,
yeah. Yeah.
a great focus and talking point.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, in the last 2 years, he's been at the helm.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I am looking forward to tasting the sumptuous royal Khmer dishes prepared by Chef Dareth.
This one, the first starter for you, the mango salad.
It's a mango.
Yes, with the sear scallop.
Yes.
And we have the dried smoked fish.
Okay. So this is the dried fish.
Yes.
Yeah. And then this is like that in Thailand they have green mango salad, right? But this is very different.
This one, the green mango.
It's also green mango, but...
But the tea, not spicy.
Very flavorful, and then there's layers and layers of flavor. Dying. Smoke. Very good. I better not finish this. I'm gonna get so full, I'm still waiting for three other dishes. The other dishes in the tasting menu were a sour barfish soup with pineapple and a delightful seared elephant fish served in tamarind sauce.
This is lobster amok.
Okay, lobster amok.
Yes.
So, it is cooked in this coconut.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
By amok, we have the garlic, shallot,
yeah.
chili.
Yeah. Wow. I'm going to go amok with this amok. So good.
Finally, some grilled beef skewers served on lemongrass with kompot black pepper sauce on the side. It's the last dish before dessert.
This is the main course.
Yeah, okay.
See the beef skewer? The jasmine, right?
Jasmine.
Yes.
Wow. Why is the meat so soft?
Yes, because this is you, the Italy.
From Italy? Wow, it's so too soft. So soft. Grab it. I thought I would stop. But it just keeps on coming in and gets better and better toward the end. This is exceptional, and I love steak. They did it the right way.
I'm pretty full, but I can never resist dessert. Here we have an assortment of traditional Cambodian treats. The dish comes with coconut ice cream, sticky rice, layer cake, and banana cake. Each pastry offered a different flavor and texture that surprised me with every bite.
Wow, this is so much food. How do you expect me to finish this by myself? Wow. Okay, I'm gonna go for the ice cream first. This is coconut ice cream with chocolate soil.
How about this?
Better than our makupuno. After having five courses, I don't know, I'm going to finish this, okay? Perfect.
perfect combination to a perfect meal. After a filling meal, it's time to meet F&B director Tomas Bianco over at the Elephant Bar.
We create drinks, actually. We always involve our bartenders. They are all from Cambodia. And so usually the direction we take when we create new drinks is to bring a bit of a Cambodian taste into it. So for example, past of a few creations recently is the Phnom Penh sling, which is a take on the Singapore sling, but highlighting a bit more local flavors. We use a gin that is made in Cambodia, Seekers gin. You will visit the distillery soon. But we also add some pink guava juice instead of pineapple juice, always trying to reflect the produce that we can find here.
The bar is looking to collaborate with the local Seekers Distillery on a signature gin specially for the hotel.
At the moment, we are working with Seekers and we are developing a new gin only for our hotel. We don't know yet the title of the gin yet. Yeah. It's still under procession. But the direction we are looking at is to have, again, to showcase Cambodia. So we're going to use some pepper, which is from Cambodia.
Yeah, the famous pepper here.
Yes, famous compote pepper. We're going to use some coffee. We are looking at using ginger, all to have a very distinct Cambodian flavor into it.
The Elephant Bar has been present since the hotel was built in 1929. Its building even served as the Philippine Embassy for a few years.
Have a drink here, try one of our cocktails, and if you can, find the monkey.
I'll try to find, have to get very drunk tonight. Before I take up Thomas on his invitation to find the monkey at the Elephant Bar, I'm checking out what there is to see in the city. Most of the country's work now is undoing what years of conflict did to its culture. Here in Phnom Penh, there's an incredible focus on cultural recovery and preservation. The National Museum houses traces of Cambodia history since prehistoric times. The biggest cultural attraction is the Royal Palace, one of the best preserved spaces in Phnom Penh. David King gives me a tour of the Royal Palace, a massive complex built in the 19th century by her ancestor, King Norodom.
This palace has been relocated from Udong since 1865 to stay in here during French colonial.
Okay.
So now we will going up to the front hall,
where
it was finished building since 1970. Yeah.
So the king lives here?
Yes, the king lives in the residence.
In the residence.
That is called Cameron's Pavilion.
Yeah.
It was built since 1930. Yeah. This is the strong hall.
The strong
hall. So it used for King Coronation Day, 12-month ceremony, and also used for high delegation that's come to have a meeting with the king as well.
Okay.
So this is the stair that with the naga.
Yes.
It seems like we walk from the earth
to the heavens. Yes. Okay.
Complex is the Royal Palace. We have throne hall, we have Cameron Pavilion, we have Moonlight Pavilion, and we also have a Silver Pagoda on the other side of the palace, but it's also still included in the complex.
So this is the royal enclosure, right?
Yes.
The throne hall is used for coronation ceremonies and other big major events. The palace stands on the intersection of the Mekong and Tonle Sap rivers, making it an ideal center of commerce. The Royal Palace is an awe-inspiring man-made creation and an inspiration for heritage management in this region. A massive mural portraying the entire story of Ramayana covers the walls of the palace.
Now we are in the pagoda area. So this pagoda, we have two names.
Okay.
One we call Silver Pagoda, and another one we call Crystal Emerald Buddha's Pagoda.
Okay.
That's why this pagoda we call Silver Pagoda, because all the floor in this pagoda
is silver.
It is made
by silver.
Okay.
And inside this pagoda, we also have one Buddha statue that made from crystal emerald.
These ones here are the stupas, right? They contain the ashes.
Yes, these two stupas of our former king. One is King Norodom, and another one is King Ongdung.
Yeah.
So that is the grand king father of our current king right now.
Okay.
So much heritage to be found in the city, and our trip is almost done. Phnom Penh has grown into a vibrant city life with artisanal businesses starting to gain foothold in the market. One of these businesses is Seekers Distillery, the first and only craft gin distillery in the country. I speak to the team about bringing artisanal gin to the country.
The three of us come from the UK and Spain, so countries with quite a rich tradition in gin making. And Mark and myself have lived in Cambodia for 7 years now, from around the world, and it was through that we realized that we had gin from everywhere, but not much coming out of Southeast Asia, and yet there are such incredible ingredients here. So we were doing a lot of
Cambodia is gaining an appreciation for artisanal premium spirits, the craft that goes into them, and the unique way they can present local ingredients.
Flavor profile is very familiar to Cambodians because we use all botanicals that are also mainly used in cooking. So then the taste is already a familiar taste to them. No?
The name Seekers reflects the business ethos, an inextinguishable curiosity that goes into the way they develop their spirits.
In the label, the stroke represents the Mekong and the Tonle Sap, actually, and then the inverted K is like confluence of rivers, of cultures, flavors, so that's why we came up with.
Tanya gives me a look at the 13 botanicals Seekers uses to mix their gin, 11 of which are native to Southeast Asia, including pandan and local basil.
This is what makes Seekers Mekong Dry Gin unique.
Yeah.
I guess juniper you might be familiar
with. Yes, juniper,
so
that
has to be in gin for it to be gin.
Yes.
And then there's a wonderful citrus that is indigenous to Southeast Asia. It's a type of green orange.
Yeah.
And these are from Battambang, which is a region close to Siem Reap, where you're going later today. And they have an amazing skin if you scratch that and smell. And the fruit is a cross between an orange and lemon and a lime.
Yeah, we have this, it's called Dalandan.
Oh, yeah,
In Manila. It smells exactly the same.
Yes.
Yeah.
And pomelo.
Of course, we have this too.
I'm sure And we also have a little bit of jasmine. Cassia bark.
So it's very exotic.
Yes, we wanted to really transport people to this part of the world. So to us, flavor from Southeast Asia is bold, fragrant, aromatic. Good,
yes.
And that's what we wanted to capture in our gin.
But when I first tried it, whoa!
It's not a classic.
Yes. But it was just so flavorful, and it was just like an explosion in your mouth. Yeah.
They built their catalog over months by extensively tasting local fruits and ingredients to find the perfect flavor for their gin.
Let me introduce you to the ladies.
Yes.
I say that because any distillery you go to, you always name your stills.
Yeah.
Usually after women, never after men.
Yeah.
In case bad luck for
Bad luck for men.
Yeah,
okay.
Exactly.
Okay.
So this one over here is Wonder.
Wonder, okay.
This one over here is Mai. Okay, so Mai potentially translates to mother in Khmer.
Yeah.
And Wonder because Cambodia is the kingdom of Wonder.
Right.
Got that one there. So making Seekers gin actually takes 3 days of setup and then 2 weeks of resting.
Okay.
So day one is called maceration or steeping.
Yeah.
And at its simplest core, all it means is everything goes inside the still, water, alcohol, or natural ingredients.
Okay.
Then we're going to add heat.
Okay.
We add heat and we go all the way up to approximately 70 degrees Celsius and we turn it off.
Okay.
And essentially, being made of copper is going to retain that heat overnight and take away all the essential oils.
Seekers Distillery puts work into every detail, from the waters used to distill the gin to the copper stills that the gin is made in. The copper is essential to the process because it strips any unwanted flavors from the gin and ensures the purest flavor of the final product.
And out flows our gin.
Yeah.
And then we collect the gin in three different parts: head, heart, and tail. Okay. So the head and the heart we discard, we don't use that. Mm-hmm. We only collect the middle part of the gin, the purest, the cleanest part of the gin. Very nice, clean flavor, and we use that.
Okay.
And then on day three, which is dilution, we'll then take our natural spring water from Kampot, dilute that heart, because the strength is gonna be approximately 85% when it comes out. So we need to add water and bring it down
to
41.3.
Yeah.
And then we leave that for 2 weeks in one of our containers.
Yes.
And then during that 2 week period, it's gonna get cleaner and softer and all those oils mix together. And then we bottle.
And then bottle, and that's the gin.
And that's the gin.
Gin distillery is a delicate process, but one they've come to master at Seekers Distillery.
I'd love to invite you for a drink.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Try some gin with me before you leave.
Okay, looking forward to that.
Perfect. So.
Okay, so cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you so much.
Pleasure.
Seekers Distillery supplies for bars within Phnom Penh's vibrant nightlife, where local bars and nightclubs stay open till late in the night. To taste Seekers Distillery's gin out in the wild, I'm headed back to the Elephant Bar for some of the bar's signature cocktails.
We have three drinks for you.
Three, huh? Yeah. Okay. I have to finish all three, huh? Yeah, okay.
Yeah. And the first one, we show you the Kaf Kaf gin and tonic.
Okay.
Then we use with the Seekers gin, Cambodia gin.
This is Seekers.
Seekers gin.
Yeah, okay. Okay.
So 45 I love
Seekers gin, okay.
Yes. And a little bit of jasmine flower syrup. And then a little bit of lemongrass bitter.
Jasmine flower. Yeah.
Some smell. Mm-hmm.
Okay, around the rim.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then
put it in, Okay.
The rice?
Put tonic.
Tonic.
Yes. Is there a special tonic you should use? Just the imperial tonic, huh?
Imperial tonic.
Okay.
Can have some smell like your jasmine flower.
Too sweet, right?
Yes.
But this is perfect, just enough. So what's next?
Phnom Penh sling to 45 of Seekers gin.
I love alcohol.
20 of lemon juice. Grenadine syrup. Grenadine. 15 ml. This is called long, just 10 ml. Litchis. Yeah, a lot of sweet.
Yeah.
And start to shake.
Okay. Can I shake also?
Yeah, you can.
Shake your booty. So there's a different color because of the grenadine.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, and those pink agave juice.
Cheers, Len. Thank you. This is what you call taksil. It's so sweet, but it's going to hit you like a ton of bricks. I can imagine. Wow. You know, Oliver this morning told me in one of these paintings, there's a monkey.
Yes.
One monkey, right?
One monkey.
Okay, I've been here for an hour.
Yeah.
Going through there's six paintings, right? I haven't found the monkey, okay? Maybe I'm the monkey. So what is your third drink?
Third drink is Femme Fatale.
Femme Fatale. Okay.
Drink.
So it's supposed to be hot chick.
Brandy, we SOP. Little bit.
That is okay.
Yeah.
Is this also sweet? No.
No, this one's sweet, this one's not sweet.
Okay.
Sparkling wine.
So that's it?
That's it.
Drink number three. I have three drinks here.
Yeah.
Okay. Which one is my favorite? I think I'm going to stick with my gin and tonic. This is slower, so I'm going to stick to this.
Yes.
Cheers. Okay, with drink in hand, all three drinks, okay? I'm going to look for the monkey, okay? So where is the monkey? No monkey there, the monkey's here. I haven't found the monkey. I cannot find the monkey. already have three drinks, okay? I cannot find the monkey. Maybe I'm the monkey. Ooh. I found the monkey, but I'm not going to tell because it took me almost 3 hours to find it, okay? So everyone has to take the same amount of time to find the monkey, okay?
After three delicious cocktails and the successful search for the elephant bar's elusive monkey, I'm more than happy to end the night before heading out again tomorrow. I did it my way. The trip to Cambodia has been an eye-opening experience. I've come to learn so much about the country's rich history and culture, and I've gotten a taste of some of the luxe experiences of modern Phnom Penh, its food, nightlife, and the incredible Raffles Hotel Le Royal that served as the main backdrop of my trip. Till then, I am Raul Manzano, and this is EIC On The Move.
I'm totally wet.
Me too.
My pants are wet. Everything's wet.
Buffalo.
Buffalo. I am kinda already tipsy. Not yet drunk. Tipsy though.
There's the monkey.